mis amigos, yo soy Meno Fernández.
Y yo soy Edgar Rodríguez y nosotros somos
las voces del rancho. Vámonos.
Me gusta tu pelo, me gustas tú.
Me gustas tú, me gustas tú.
Me gustan tus ojos, me gustas tú.
Me gustas tú, me gustas tú.
I met Edgar when I was 12 years old in sixth grade, in the sixth grade of the Nimitz Junior High School.
Mr. Holzclaw.
Mr. Holzclaw, homeroom, ¿verdad?
Homeroom.
We had homeroom for 3 years straight, so I think that was the only class that we were together, no?
Yeah, we only had a homeroom.
We only had homeroom together. I was 12 years old. Like pretty much he was roughly the same age. Sí, pero ahí fue donde conocimos y...
My first impression of Mariano was kind of crazy because I remember the first time I saw him, the day I met him, there was this other guy, Miguel Solorio, in our class, right? I guess apparently they already knew each other, right? So I walk into the class and they're fucking play fighting, pero de verdad, like, pa, se ya, pum, punches, vergazos, bien recio. I was like, what the fuck? Chisatos sangrones, qué pedo, you know? Y así se llevaban, though, but like every day, like, se miraban, what's up, dog? Pa, 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 da, da. That was their everyday greeting. Like, you know how people were like, hey, what's up, you know?
Yeah, we were high five with the liver.
To the paz, you know? And I was like, damn, this nigga's like kind of crazy, you know? But that was my first impression of this dude when I met him. It was kind of crazy, and as we went along, like as the years progressed, we had homeroom for 3 years. I remember porque yo pasé entonces ya estaba trying to get into the music and, you know, trying to be a musician, tocaba con mi dad, tocaba los keyboards. So back then, o sea, era raro un morrito de la edad de nosotros que escuchara música en español. It wasn't cool. O sea, you had to listen to rap or you had to listen to whatever was going on in that time. To actually, you know, be considered a cool kid, you know,
exactly.
And we were, well, I was listening to Spanish music, but more low key, you know, because I knew people were, it was like kind of frowned upon, se puede decir, no.
Vale.
Pero Mariano le valía verga, ese güey llegaba con su Walkman, escuchando los Tigres del Norte a todo lo que da, so ya.
Vaya güey, o sea, not really que me valiera verga, pero I didn't think people would be hearing my headphones.
Oh, that's why.
I thought that was on purpose, you know, my headphones, pero más yo lo voy a oír, so I wouldn't crank it. Y pues ya gusto, pero nunca imaginaba que debo bleed out, like you know. Y pues se notaba what I was hearing, and obviously
yeah.
He noticed what I was listening to, you know.
And
that's
like,
how people noticed what I was listening to.
Yeah, and I'd be like, oh shit, this fool listens to this kind of music too. I'm like, oh that. So that, like, desde un principio, I was like, oh shit, como que eso me atrayó Mariano, like, you know, dije, oh, this feels cool, you know. So then, yeah, I guess we started talking along, ya nos hicimos, you know, friends. Y back then, me acuerdo que estaba muy de moda lo de los cholitos, ¿te acuerdas?
Andale.
The gangster, everybody want to be a gangster and shit, you know?
Yeah, so, con la clique de la escuela.
Yeah, y pues entonces Mariano,
esos cabrones.
No, que Mariano tenía un primo que era medio cholillo y shit, so ahí lo miraba con ellos y yo, oh shit, you know, so then it was kind of like, fuck, should I hang around with this guy or shouldn't I? But I mean, should I be a gangster too or what the fuck, you know? I literally kind of like early on found out that I, like the gangster life wasn't for me. I was more like more of a lover than a fighter, you know, so I kind
of... Llegó bien contento ahí al second Alexander.
Oh, yeah, second Alexander.
I'm in already. They called me in. Oh,
yeah,
shit.
Yeah, una putita me arribaron, so I got into the gang and shit.
Según nosotros, ya bien chel, como se le había dicho, back in the... Que, like, the late 80s, ¿eh?
Late 80s,
boy. Late 80s, because, yeah, late 80s, exactly. Yeah. Late 90s.
Yeah. But that wasn't for me. Nah, yeah. I found out right away. I'm not a gangster. I like to tag. I was right on the buses, right on the walls. That was kind of more my thing, you know. That's as far as I went. Pero then that I see the cholillo.
People might relate tagging almost being like a cholo, but it wasn't the same thing.
It was a little different.
Tagger.
So then yeah, once we got into like getting out of the whole junior high, cuando ya entramos iba a entrar a la high school. Fue cuando Mariano ya empezaba a escribir. Me acuerdo que me enseñaba canciones, corridos. Y, check out this song I wrote and shit. Y yo lo miraba, be like, oh, shit, it don't rhyme. But, okay, that's cool. You know, I mean, I guess I kind of knew. Like, I'm like, oh, that's cool. It's cool. It's fucking cool, you know. But in my mind, I was like, damn, this shit don't rhyme at all. So I would be like, no, but that's cool, you know. But
that's where everybody starts.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I wasn't writing songs yet either, you know. But I knew that they had to fucking rhyme, right? Because una pinche canción tiene que rimar a huevo, you know? So I would be like, oh, that's cool, dude. Wow. Y total que, once we got into high school, ya se empezó lo de Chalino, like super fucking strong. Estaba bien fuerte Chalino. And we were both like listening to Chalino, you know? Ya para entonces ya.
He was like what the underground bands.
Yeah, ándale. Sí, sí.
Están pegando machino. Chalino was underground. O sea,
yeah,
he was almost to that point when he was going to break through, like to be
mainstream.
You know, mainstream. Unfortunately, pues pasó lo que pasó, you know? before it happened, pero
Y ya once we got in, both got into that, it was over. Like, ahí son de bar. Porque yo tocaba en un grupo, pero ya cuando empezó lo de Chalino, pues yo también agarré un acordeón y empecé a tocar canciones de Chalino. It was weird. People looking at me, what the fuck are you singing, dude? Like, porque en ese entonces apenas estaba entrando mucha gente, no lo conocía. It was more like, como dice Mariano, it was an underground thing. Entonces, pero definitivamente Chalino was like a fucking humongous influence in, you know, in our lives.
And aparte de Chalino being an influence in our lives, yo creo que también, knowing the fact, cuando me di cuenta que your dad had the group,
yeah,
los Faraones, even that brought me more closer to you.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's like, true. Like, yeah, because you started going with us, huh?
Yeah, I started going.
Yeah,
he would like, hey, when is your next gig? Oh, yeah. Tal día. Oh, can I go? Yeah. Y, when is your next one? Can I go? Yeah,
Simón. El siguiente concierto va a ser el sábado.
You know, he cheated on the drums, to dad in the bass. I remember he would be playing, he would be onto ese brinquito.
Yeah.
The little jump that he has, you know?
Yeah.
His signature
move.
So, you know, even that got me even closer and more interested in music.
Yeah.
You know, aparte que me gusta la música, even that, because then his dad had the studio. I'm like, you have a studio también? Like,
yeah.
Like, even though it was a little, como lo tenía back then.
Yeah.
But I was like, wow, you have a studio también? Wow, like.
It was sweet out of fucking La Bamba, that, when he walks into the, some weird shit.
He was like, right. Watching La Bamba, when I started getting, oh, you have a studio at the minute? We're like, what the hell?
Yeah.
It was like crazy, you know, like, and so even that got me more interested in it.
So the story behind the studio is my dad one day, well, we were musicians already, right? Y mi jefe un día, pues mi jefe, he's always been super impulsive. To this day, he's been impulsivo, mi jefe. Un día se le pegó lo que era que quería comprar un estudio. So then he goes and he fucking spends money. Well, it was a weird story behind that. Oh, that's another story though. So he goes and se ensarta con, como con, I don't know, like $20,000 worth of credit. And he buys a tape machine. He fucking buys a couple of microphones, and then so
which
then
the
he
first recording the yeah.
So then, which I still have in the other room. He buys the stuff, and then he takes it home and he tells my mom, hey, you know, I'm gonna put a studio in the back. Let me go. All right, my mom's like, okay, what did you gotta do? So he sets up a little studio, and then this man go un amigo de él llega ahí le ayuda a hacer grabaciones. Y mi jefe, like, he didn't know how to turn anything on. He just wanted to have a studio, so when we wanted to record, we could go in there. O sea, the band, my dad's band. Total que we record an album, and then yeah, later on, that man left. He left and he left unos trabajos empezados. So then we pretty much what we did is I went in there. My dad told me, hey, pues, you know, these people want to finish their music. Why don't you go in there and see if you like that stuff? You know, para vender todo.
Figure it out.
Yeah, yeah. So then I was like, fuck it, I'll go in there. You know, I started going in there, putting on the tapes, and I would hear him. I'm like, oh shit, you know, I got like instantly hooked on it. So I said, fuck it, I'll learn how to do this. Y así empecé, you know, I started doing that. And out of that salió the la onda de grabarme un disco solista. And I told Mariano, hey, dude, I'm going to record an album. So I met these guys, which were called Los Plebes del Norte, which was Alex Arellano, Gustavo Arellano, Panchito, and mi compadre Álvaro. Back then he was my compadre. Yeah, we met them, we were all the same age. I told him, hey, I met these kids. They're, you know, they're young. You know, they're our age. And they play, you know, norteño. Because back then, all the grupos were old motherfuckers, yeah? Bigotones, así, pinches pantalones, así, like those shirts, así, you know?
Yeah.
That was the norteño músico, you know? No había morros, you know? So they were young. So we're like, oh, shit. So I told him, hey, I met these kids. And they're going to help me do an album. Y la chingada. Y dice, no, pues, que yo también, you know, I want to record an album. So total, we started recording my album, his album, and those guys' album, three albums at the same time, and then that's where it all started. O sea, ya él es, era Mariano Fernández, el errante de Sinaloa, yo era Edgar Rodríguez, el compa amable, y los otros eran los Plebes del Norte, which they went on to change their name to Clave Norteño. Right. And with those albums is where it all started. Yeah,
yeah, their music, and it had a lot to do with our sound. The first song we came out with, you know, it was like, ya fue Clave Norteña. Obviously, we did my album, his album, and then we did our album together. Well, actually, con the Voces albums, lo hicimos con Rebelión.
The first one.
Yeah. And then we used.
Yeah, el segundo ya.
And then we used. Porque
for the second one.
Yeah,
porque en el primero, haz de cuenta que había un grupo que se llamaban la Rebelión Norteña de Esteban Sagaste. Mm-hmm. They were like the house band que acompañaban a todos los artistas de Don Pedro Rivera.
Y que todos los artistas querían que los acompañaran.
Yeah. So nos acompañaron el primer disco, and then after that we were like, no, we want our, you know, our sound, you know, a different sound, para no sonar, porque todos los discos sonaban igual, de todos los artistas, and we didn't want that.
K
¿Qué tal, mis amigos, compas?
Las Voces del Rancho. Los invitamos al canal de Yellow Room Music a través de YouTube.
Para que conozca nuestra historia.
Estén pendientes.
Échale.